Thank you. Good afternoon. And thanks again to IDSA for the invitation to be here. And our most efficient coordinator, Smriti, thank you for everything. This paper is the result of two different journeys I have taken in my life. The first, the official journey of some 33 years in diplomatic service, and much of it spent under the shadow of the armed conflict in the country. And after retirement, a different life back to academia, learning to speak in my own voice, and publishing books on heritage and work with the National Trust of Sri Lanka. When I prepared this paper, the Paris attacks had not yet occurred. And I've been thinking that the way the localities were chosen for those attacks, the cafe, the concert hall, the football stadium, are in fact attacks on the heart of what is French culture, cuisine, arts, sports. This is what France projects to the world, and which apparently is being rejected now by those who attacked her. Is this a kind of a response to the French attempt to unify its cultural pressures, or the way France feels its culture should be projected within the country and how people should think? It's kind of a thing, it's a thought that perhaps we should be looking at, because throughout the conference we've been talking about, should we unify our approaches to culture, or should we promote the diversification? So culture is closely interwoven with geography and history. Sri Lanka's island character is a part of its historical formation and its biogeography. Although few people think of it in this way, in reality, Sri Lanka is a reasonably large island surrounded by many small islands of quite different character. And these islands reflect the influence of visitors from the past for trade, leisure, conquest, from Delft in the north, where the wild ponies still run, to Manna with its baobab trees and donkeys of African stock, to Count Timoni's Island in the south and the colonial lighthouses in the Great Basses and Little Basses at the southern extremity. We had no choice. Sri Lanka's destiny was to be open to the world. Sri Lanka's strategic location at the center of the Indian Ocean is much in the news today. In ancient times, it was known for its two ports, Mantai and Gokana, on either side of the island, safe shelters in the different monsoons that drove the sailing ships traveling east and west. Sri Lanka is, nevertheless, in reality, it is endowed with many smaller harbors in proximity to estuaries of rivers flowing in a circular pattern from the central hills. The central mountain, Sripada, known to the Buddhists as Sripada, was known to the Hindus as Sivanoli Padamale. And there were five ancient Hindu temples, Naguleswaran in the north, Ketiswaran in the northwest, Koneswaran in the east, Munneswaran in the west, and Thondeswaran in the south, all destroyed during Portuguese times and all rebuilt except for the temple in the south. Within this context, Sri Lanka and India share obviously a special relationship, as witnessed by the chronicles, inscriptions, and other archaeological evidence. Even the modern maps of the Mauryan Empire today show the island by its name then, Tamrapani. And the way I look at the bilateral relations and the linkages between Sri Lanka and India, that it reflects on the one hand the pressure since historic times for joining together their destinies, and on the other hand the impulses for separate development. This pattern is very clearly seen in the work of political scientists who have used linkage theory extensively in the analysis of the relations. One school of thought lays emphasis on processes. Sarala Fernando, for instance, refers to the strong internal dynamics that characterized the island civilization and its existence as a clearly demarcated and independent geopolitical and geocultural entity during a period of nearly 2.5 millennia. On the other hand, Urmila Padnis and others question the perceived tendency for linkage theory studies to be focused on processes and less on structures, pointing out that Indo-Ceylon socio-cultural subsystem boundaries overlap in a highly significant way, resulting in a rich mix of racial, cultural, and religious linkages with all the waves of migration to the island coming from India. In this same line of thought, K. Indrapala suggests that the southernmost parts of India, comprising mainly the modern Indian states of Kerala and Tamil Nadu, and the southern parts of Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, together with Sri Lanka, formed a single cultural region. As an extension of this analogy, Indrapala argued that the Pok Straits should be seen as a unifier. However, the reality is that fisheries issues have proved contentious in the bilateral relations and have today set the Jaffna fishermen against their counterparts in Tamil Nadu. It is interesting to compare the competition for fishery resources with the cultural influences, as stories are still told today in Jaffna, how when there was a new film in Tamil Nadu, the intrepid youth would swim over, see the film, and swim back afterwards. The power of the entertainment media is not to be underestimated, as Sri Lanka's multimedia reflects the overwhelming influence of Indian channels and Bollywood music and dance styles. Yet in an interesting twist, the genesis and impact of the Tamil Nadu film industry is said to have been rescued from the doldrums by the Sri Lankan diaspora, which is an area which has not been examined so far. In my view, one area which needs to be more researched is that of bilateral economic interactions, which have flourished since historic times. Reviving these ancient economic connections may form the key to both nation building and strengthening of bilateral and regional cooperation. I will not go through the description that I have in my paper, because I think you have it already, where I compare the economic interests of Madras and Ceylon in colonial times, which were sewn together, and after independence, I suggest that on both sides there was a process of separation and prioritizing of each other's interests. I would like to underline this fact that I mentioned in the paper, that thanks to the negotiations of the Indo-Ceylon problem, which was to occupy the Sri Lankan leaders over the first 40 years after independence, that is the indentured labor from India, we do have now a framework of understanding which could very well form the framework for the return of the Sri Lankan refugees in camps in Tamil Nadu, who are now welcome to return to their homes. I'll skip all this and then go to what is the situation now, and that is after India's economic liberalization in the 1990s, the forces for economic integration have regained center stage. We have now India-Sri Lanka Free Trade Agreement, and there's ongoing talks for its extension to a comprehensive economic partnership. And the Indian projects are significant, where connectivity has come to the forefront. Rehabilitation of Kankasanthure Harbour in the north of Sri Lanka, the restoration of the railway track up to Thalaimana, permitting rail services to reopen between Thalaimana and Rameshwaram, the development of Trincomalee, where the Indian Oil Company has taken over the tank farm, and so on. But the question is how far this trend towards seamless connectivity can be taken. If the pattern that I had suggested still holds good, just as the forces of globalization push increasing integration, will there be a counter thrust? And if so, from where will it come? I think it might come with this idea of the building of a bridge between Sri Lanka and India, which has been espoused on both sides at the highest political level by both India and Sri Lanka. Already the newspaper articles suggest that there's quite a lot of public controversy in this regard. Similarly, the tourism authorities developed what they call the Ramayana Trail. And it has been a huge marketing success, drawing so many Indian tourists to Sri Lanka. But the academics question the validity of the historical evidence and the underlying political motivations. Nevertheless, tourism has had a largely positive benefit, and who would have thought so? we would have thought Sri Lanka has nothing different to offer to Indians, but they are flocking to Sri Lanka. Thousands of Sri Lankan pilgrims also undertake the Buddhist circuit every year. On occasion, they are rebuffed by sporadic attacks from fringe groups. And sometimes when I was in diplomatic service, we were concerned to see how we could try to mitigate such attacks, but it was impossible. These were spontaneous attacks that came from time to time. It creates huge negative publicity, dries up the tourist flows, but then again, the irresistible pull of the cultural factors takes over once again. International relations analysts have often linked the slow pace of regional cooperation in South Asia, the asymmetries among the partners, and with India's dominant size, population, resources, and military assets, leading to a notion of discomfort with the big brother. So how can foreign policy and diplomacy help to encourage the positive over the negative? My paper has argued that fostering economic synergies can lead the way, but we do need to do some work on how to harmonize official and unofficial transactions and to cross-border transactions. I would also like to make a mention here of a relatively new branch of diplomacy, which takes note of technological advances in communications and the rise of an active citizenry, what is known as public diplomacy, which underlines the importance of listening to the other and building relationships rather than one-way messaging. It upholds the value of attraction through ideas, such as exchanges and international broadcasting. And I believe the thoughtful deployment of public diplomacy is already playing a significant role today in what we see in Sri Lanka as the transformation of India's big brother image into a big sister, constant, reliable, and attentive to the siblings' needs. I see now that in almost all announcements about technical cooperation projects in Sri Lanka, they put in a little phrase saying these are the request of the government of Sri Lanka, which is, I think, part of this public diplomacy. It does work very well, in my view. I think everyone who's spoken has highlighted the importance of cross-cultural sensitization and partnerships in education, the arts, music, drama, and so on. It's international broadcasting that I, in my view, is more problematic. On the one hand, I agree there are many differing opinions on the limits of artistic freedom and should there be limits at all. Our artists, our film directors take that view. Yet in my personal view, and this is because I looked at all of the channels that were being beamed into Sri Lanka, the channel TVs for the past week before writing this, and I found that there were so many negative stereotypes that are projected in these popular teledramas and Bollywood movies: violence, unbridled emotions, avarice, hatred, often outnumber the positive values. And for me, it made me yearn for the beauty of simple things and the thought-provoking moral compass of the Satyajit Ray era. So finally, is there a way to break free from the dialectic of joining together and separate development, which we've outlined in the first part of the presentation? And I believe an answer may lie within this expression, cultural heritage, in looking at the two components of that notion separately. Dealing with culture per se involves a component of enumeration and a certain level of categorization, levels of power, which hark back to our roots, ethnicity, race, religion, majority, minority, male, female. On the other hand, dealing with heritage is a more consensual process, and its objective of heritage conservation and protection is aimed at the future generations. Heritage encompasses both tangible and intangible assets and values. Most of the attention today in UNESCO, for instance, is on the protection of the sites and monuments due to the recent phenomenon of extremist attacks on World Heritage sites. But what I find is that our work in the National Trust has recognized that the younger generations are drawn more to the protection of nature and its sustainable use. It's a huge supporting network of civil society, little groups which have spotlighted baby elephants being taken out of the wild to private companies planting on reserved land and so on. And so my suggestion is that we in South Asia should put together a platform of regional cooperation on the basic elements of nature: water, air, land, and the animals. We in Sri Lanka are fortunate right now. We have a president who for the first time is interested in environmental protection. Earlier, the presidents would take these powerful portfolios of finance, defense, but for some reason, there is a president who has announced that and taken a great deal of personal interest in environmental issues. Nalanda is rising again as a South Asian center of learning. It reminds us to be mindful of the Buddha's message of protection of the environment and kindness to animals, delivered thousands of years ago in this subcontinent, long before the modern environmental movement took shape in the West. As climate change hovers over the planet and everybody waits to respond to the inevitable disaster, my question is, can we, for once in South Asia, be ahead of the curve? Thank you.